Folliculogenesis is the development of follicles that are part of a reserve, which has been in the ovaries of female mammals since they are born. Chorts or groups of follicles are developing cyclically from this reserve during the life of the female mammal. Each of these follicles houses a primary oocyte and is made up of follicular cells which surround the membrane of the oocyte. These cells will undergo some transformations that allow the ovaries to develop a dual function. The first of them is gametogenesis, which consists of the development of the female gamete or oocyte, which is located inside the follicle. In the female, this process is known as oogenesis. The second function that the ovary performs is steroidogenesis, and consists of the synthesis of steroid hormones produced by the follicle that houses the oocyte, which also contribute to its growth and maturation. These two processes happen at the same time in order for ovulation to occur so that there is a possible fertilization. However, not all oocytes in a group of follicles that begin to develop will end up being ovulated. The number of follicles that will ovulate depends on the species in question. For example, in monoestric females like humans, cattle, and horses, ovulation of only one follicle usually occurs in each sexual cycle, while in polyestric females such as sheep, goats, pigs, canines, and felines, ovulation of several follicles occurs at the same time. Here we will explain the process that leads to the ovulation of a single follicle, as usually happens in monoestric females. The individual process of each of these follicles that are part of a cohort that develops simultaneously is the following. Each primordial follicle is surrounded by ovarian stromal cells. These cells will also have an important function in more advanced states as they will begin to differentiate until they form another type of cell, which will be part of the follicle, along with the follicular cells, that in this state, are the only ones that make it up. The follicular cells in the primordial follicles are flat, and they are also known as pregranulosa cells. These flat follicular cells then change to a cubic shape. Initially, they make up a single layer. That is to say, the follicle is characterized by being unilaminar. From this stage onwards, there are some variations in the literature regarding the name given to the follicles according to their stage of development. Here we will mention the most frequent classification. Therefore, at this stage of development, the follicle is classified as a primary follicle. Later, the follicular cells, which are now called granular cells, divide, forming several layers around the oocyte. Therefore, the follicle is now characterized by being multilaminar. Then, basal lamina arises around the granulosa cells that delimits the follicle from the surrounding ovarian stroma. This originates from the secretions of the granulosa cells themselves. Additionally, the ovarian stromal cells also begin to organize around the basal lamina to form what will be the precursor cells of the theca folliculi. Similarly, granulosa cells and oocytes secrete a mucoid substance that is deposited on the cell membrane of the oocyte, forming what is known as the zona pellucida, which basically consists of a layer of glycoproteins. At the same time, the granulosa cells begin to develop cytoplasmic extensions that cross the zona pellucida. This in order to establish direct contact with the plasma membrane of the oocyte, and thus be able to provide it with the necessary nutrients for its maturation. Additionally, the granulosa cells are also connected to each other through gap junctions or nexus unions. Therefore, this is the source of intercellular communication between the cells contained within the basal lamina. In this state of follicular development, it is classified as a secondary follicle that is characterized by being multilaminar. Until now, the different stages of development of the existing follicles are also called preantral follicles, and their evolution to antral follicles only occurs after puberty. For this new state to arise, first there is greater proliferation of granulosa cells, which will begin to produce follicular fluid. This will cause the granulosa cells to separate due to the creation of fluid-filled cavities. These cavities with liquid inside progressively join together until they form a single cavity called follicular antrum. At first, the antrum has a semilunar shape, but over time, it increases greatly in volume due to a greater accumulation of follicular fluid. The granulosa cells move towards the wall of the follicle so that the oocyte is located eccentrically, that is, oriented towards the periphery. However, this is surrounded by a few granulosa cells called the cumulus oophorus. These allow us to actively contribute to the growth of the oocyte through the cytoplasmic projections that have been previously established and that are now fully developed. In addition to this, at this moment of development, the theca cells are already completely differentiated, since now form two concentric layers of cells. An inner layer of polygonal cells, known as the theca interna, containing a large number of blood vessels and secretory epithelial cells, since it is specifically here where ovarian steroidogenesis occurs, which is the production of steroid hormones by the ovary. On the other hand, the external layer of the theca, known as the theca externa, is characterized by being made up of fibrous connective tissue cells, such as fibroblasts and collagen. The theca external is arranged in a spheroid shape, so that it gradually mixes with the ovarian stroma. Therefore, this layer also contains smooth muscle cells or contractile filaments, which are also in the ovarian stroma and which could play some role in the contractility of the follicle for future expulsion of the oocyte. Both layers of the theca folliculi receive abundant vascularization, although it is greater in the theca interna. Also, both contain lymphatic vessels and nerve endings. However, the blood vessels that are part of the theca do not pass through the basal lamina that surrounds the granulosa cells. Therefore, the granulosa cells and the oocyte receive nutrients from the blood by diffusion through the basal lamina. This is because the environment of the stratum granulosum is avascular. In this state, the follicle is called a tertiary follicle. Subsequently, the antral follicle reaches maturity, acquires a size of 10 millimeters or more, and is now called the preovulatory follicle or Graafian follicle. In monoestric females, of each group of primordial follicles in the reserve that begin the growth process during each ovarian cycle, only one of them becomes a Graafian follicle. This is the one that will carry out ovulation and is known as the dominant follicle. Other follicles degenerate, even those that have reached antral follicle stages. This process of degeneration of the follicles that have not achieved dominance is known as follicular atresia and leads to the gradual decrease of the oocyte reserve over time. After ovulation, the primary oocyte that has been released from the dominant follicle continues to be surrounded by a group of granulosa cells known as the corona radiata, which must be crossed by sperm for fertilization to occur. These cells perform metabolic and mechanical functions, that is, in addition to contributing to the development and maturation of the oocyte, they also help protect it from possible damage during its journey through the fallopian tubes. Additionally, primary oocyte becomes a secondary oocyte just after ovulation occurs, since it is at this moment when meiosis I that had begun and which was paused ends. This is known as the diploteen stage. Then, this same oocyte, which is now a secondary oocyte, begins a second meiosis, which again pauses, and that it is only terminated if it is penetrated by a sperm. Should this happen, the secondary oocyte will become a mature ovum, which will later become a zygote when it has completely fused with the sperm. Instead, if fertilization does not occur, the secondary oocyte degenerates around 24 hours after ovulation. On the other hand, after ovulation occurs, the remaining granulosa and theca cells remain in the ovary, which made up the follicle before it ruptured. These mix and give rise to a transitory structure, which is initially called the hemorrhagic body, because a blood clot forms as a result of the rupture of the blood vessels that were part of the theca. But then, these theca and granulosa cells that have remained there will transform into luteal cells, which make up the corpus luteum, or yellow body. Initially, it is an early corpus luteum, which will later become a mature corpus luteum. This performs important endocrine functions related to the preparation of the uterus for a future pregnancy, among other functions. If fertilization does not occur, the corpus luteum degenerates and becomes a structure called corpus albicans, which is made up of fibrous scar tissue. Finally, all of this is part of the ovarian cycle, or female sexual cycle, which is regulated by different hormones associated with the reproductive system of females. This consists of different names and stages, depending on the species in question, as shown in the final slide.